信をお願いします。
はい、どうぞ。君は切りないからな、黙ってるともう。
こちら先生、
もういい、もういいよ。
はい、こちら先生、お願いします。はい、
はい、
日本人ばかりじゃない。はい、もういい。
Ladies and gentlemen, I am Khaldoun Azhari, former club president. Happy to welcome you to the FCCJ today, which is now situated in this sparkling new location, but returns its mission and long history of bringing in top speakers who command worldwide attention. One of those distinguished speakers who have made headlines is sitting here beside me, I am honored to say. Returning to the FCC podium more than five times more, we don't have the exact number, but he's coming back here today is Mr. Shintaro Ishihara, the former Tokyo governor who famously told the world about the Japan that can't say no. Governor Ishihara, who retired from the post in 2012 after 13 years in office, is accompanied by Mr. Masaru Sasaki, a former vice president of Tokyo Metropolitan Health and Medical Treatment Corporation and an expert in disaster response and management. They are here today to promote enhanced medical response to save Japanese troops inside and outside Japan. Ishihara-san, who before becoming governor served in the Diet Japan Parliament for nearly three decades, he is concerned that while members of the Japanese self-defense forces risk their lives in defense of their country, their lives, quote, are not necessarily defended. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, may I ask that you give a round of applause to our honored guest, Governor Ishihara and Mr. Sasaki. Thank you.
今日はここでですね、お話をする機会を与えていただきまして、大変ありがとうございました。ただ、私は非常に躊躇しております。というのは、私がこれからお話をする内容は、まさに日本という国家としての恥なんです。私はこの問題について長いこと取り組んできましたけれども、ついにこの10月にですね、ある事件が自衛隊に関して起きまして、一人の軍人が死にました。そして一人は重傷でしたけれども、これに対する詳細の報告というのは依然として政府といいましょうか、自民党の部会にはされていないようですし、この間のその問題について、私は今日同伴しました、私が推判してですね、内閣の官房の参与をずっと務めていただいた佐々木先生、この方は、日本で最もプロミネントな危機管理のお医者さんでして、首都圏で随一の、その救急病院、疲労病院というものを作った功労者です。で、まあ、その経験と生かして、
ここでちょっと通訳しましょう。ここでちょっと通訳。
あ、そうですか。いいですか。
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to speak before you today. I'm a little concerned about actually speaking today because the topic that I'm going to be speaking about is something that is very embarrassing or very shameful for Japanese. This is actually, however, a matter that has concerned me for many, many years. And as a result, or in spite of my concerns over the years, in October of this year, we finally had an accident occur in which a self-defense force member lost his life. One person was severely critically injured, but the other person died. In spite of this terrible thing happening, neither the government nor the LDP has basically offered any comments about this. Therefore, I decided to go with my associate, a doctor that I have admired for many, many years, Dr. Sasaki, who is sitting next to me. He is one of the most prominent doctors in Japan, and his specialty is emergency medicine. He was instrumental in establishing the Tokyo Metropolitan Hiro-O Hospital, which is renowned for its emergency medical facilities.
これは首都圏 で, です、ね、随一の救急病院でして、広く小笠原諸島までもカバーしています。そして先般ですね、ドイツと確かフランスの救急病院の専門家が視察に来ましたが、非常に高く評価して、帰られました。で、彼らに言わせるとですね、もし、いや、これは佐々木先生が言われたことですけども、交通事故で亡くなったモナコの王妃のグレス・ケリーさんはですね、日本の病院だったら助かってたでしょう。それぐらいの、危機管理についてのですね、超専門家ですから、私は自衛隊の問題が非常に心配なので、私から推判しまして、安倍内閣の内閣の官房の参与を勤めて2年間勤めていただきました。それと、合わせて私の友人の亀井君が推判した日大の新しい危機管理学科の教授にも就任していただきました。で、この佐々木先生が2年間にわたって随分具体的なそのアドバイスを政府にしてきました。特にこれはその自衛隊の軍人のですね、生命の管理に関するそのずさんな政府の姿勢に対する批判でしたけども、つい2年間それが一向にその変えられることがありませんでした。端的に申しますと、もう一つ端的に申しますと、世界の軍隊の中で衛生兵が一旦緊急の時に使うモルヒネを持たせてもらえない国家は日本だけなんです。これは日本の厚生省のですね、天下りとその非常に硬直した行政のせいでありまして、いまだに日本の衛生兵はそのモルヒネを持たせてもらえない、そういう現状が非常に端的な例です。
So as I was mentioning, Dr. Sasaki has been instrumental in building this wonderful hospital, which is probably the best emergency medicine hospital in Tokyo. Recently, it was visited by doctors, experts from Germany and France. They regarded the facilities and the systems in place very, very highly. In fact, they said, and perhaps this is something that Dr. Sasaki himself should say, they said that if Princess Grace Kelly, Princess Grace of Monaco, had been rushed to this hospital after her accident, she might have been saved. That is how highly they regarded the crisis management systems that were in place here. And because of his great expertise, I asked him to join me today. He is now officially the special advisor to the cabinet on medical matters. He has also been closely associated with the efforts of my friend, Mr. Shizuka Kamei, a former politician. At Nihon University, there is now a crisis management department, and Mr. Sasaki and Dr. Sasaki has been instrumental in helping to build up this department as well. Over the past 2 years, Dr. Sasaki has, as I mentioned earlier, served as a special advisor to the cabinet. He has worked very, very hard to try to improve the medical services and systems for the self-defense forces, because he thinks that the current situation is very, very inferior or lacking or problematic. He has worked very, very hard and has been very, very critical of the current situation. However, over the past 2 years, in spite of his efforts, very little improvement has been actually realized. Just to give a very, very simple example of what is wrong with the self-defense forces, the self-defense forces are the only military organization in the world where the combat medics are not allowed to carry morphine. And this is, and the reason for this is because of this vertical administration system where there's compartmentalization within the bureaucracies, and the Health and Labor Welfare Ministry will not allow morphine to be held.
フィリピンの塾の話を。フィリピンの塾の話を。
あ、
うちの塾の話を。
実はですね、非常に曖昧なその地位をしか得られてない日本の自衛隊、まさにこれは日本の国軍ですけども、この軍人がですね、いかにその中途半端な立場に置かれているかってことを一つ調査ですけども、私があの運輸大臣をする前にですね、自民党の外交調査会の会長をしておりました。その時にカンボジアのポルポトが倒れた後の自由選挙の、管理監視にですね、自衛隊員とボランティアの方々が向こうに行かれまして、あの向こうの初めての選挙を手伝ったんですけども、その時に、ボランティアの日本人の方がポルポトの残党に射殺されました。で、私はあのたまたまパラオで好きなダイビングして遊んでたんですけど、夏休み呼び戻されまして、調査会を開きましたら、外務省の役人がですね、会の始まる前に事実関係についてお話しますと言って、まあ、逐一状況について話をしたんですけど、最後にその男は何と言ったかというと、いや、これが民間人で助かりました、もし自衛隊が殺されていたらえらいことになったでしょうと言ったんで、私は激怒しましてね、そんなバカな言い方があるかということで、まあ、あの会議始まったんですけども、ことごとさようにですね、非常にその曖昧な地位しか与えられてない日本の国軍であるその自衛隊の軍人がですね、何かのその軍事作業の中で死亡したりするということは大変なことなんです。今回ついにそれが起こりました。10月にフィリピンでの、日本フィリピンアメリカとの合同演習で参加していた日本の軍人が途中その現場に搬送される途中に、フィリピン人が多分運転したんでしょうけども、現地の人が運転する車がですね、交通事故を起こして一人が重傷で、一人が病院に搬送されて亡くなりました。そしてこれは詳しく後から佐々木先生からお話になると思いますけども、なんと4日間病院で生き延びれて4日目に亡くなったんですけど、その間その自衛隊はですね、航空自衛隊に病人なり怪我人を搬送する専用機があるのに、それを一向に使わなかった。なぜ使わなかったかわけがわからない。そして結局その方は亡くなって、意外となって日本に帰ってきたんですけど、まあ、これ非常に私に解せない話ですが、この間もそのことを問い詰めるために防衛省の事務次官になってみました。これ会いましたら、次官がニヤニヤニヤニヤ笑いながら一種の言い訳で、でも石原さんお分かりでしょう、こういう問題はとっても時間がかかるんですよ、解決に。おっしゃることは分かりますけど、なかなかこれは難しい問題で、とにかく時間がください。時間かけるとあって4日間ほったらかして、これその運ぶべき人間を運ばずに殺してしまったっていうのも有識問題ですけども、こういう事態がなぜかね、自民党の部会にも報告されてないし、自民党のその専門の政治家たちもこれについて何のコメントもしない。私はたまりかねて、あの立憲民主党の枝野君にですね、この問題について君積極的に考えてくれと会って話したいと言ったら、私に会うと目立って仲間に迷惑をかけるから会いたくないから、佐々木先生と電話で話したいということでおざらになって、そんなことはすみませんから、今日あえてこうやってですね、ここで内外のメディアの方の前でそのことの実態についてのご報告をさせて、ご批判をいただきたいと思っております。
はい、 So, as I mentioned, the Japanese combat medics are not even allowed to carry morphine, and this is an indication of the very unstable or unclear or very sort of, worrisome situation that the self-defense forces find themselves in. And they are, after all, our military forces. They are there to protect us. But they are in a situation where everything is just simply not completely worked out. In fact, this current situation reminded me of something that happened many, many years ago, before I became the Minister of the Transport Ministry. Before that, I was the head of the Foreign Relations Committee within the LDP, and that was a time when there were peacekeeping operations by the United Nations and the Japanese Self-Defense Forces and Japanese civilian volunteers took part in the supervision or monitoring of the elections that were held after the Pol Pot administration had fallen. And unfortunately, however, there was an attack on some of these people by some sympathizers, probably with of Pol Pot. And as a result, a Japanese volunteer with his PKO forces was killed. And I happened to have been vacationing in Palau at the time because it was summertime. But because of my responsibilities, I immediately came back to Japan and I held a committee meeting to discuss this matter. And a representative from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs came, and he started off the meeting by explaining the facts of what had happened. But after he had explained what had happened, he sort of laughed and shrugged and said, well, at least we were very lucky because it was a civilian that had been killed. Can you imagine the furor that would have erupted if it had been an LCDF official self-defense force personnel that had been killed? But I immediately, of course, became very, very angry because this is very, very symptomatic, as I mentioned earlier, of the very callous attitude that the government has shown toward the self-defense forces. And as I mentioned earlier, I have been worried about this issue for many, many years. And now, as I mentioned also again earlier, in October, there was a person who died from the self-defense forces. This was when there were tri-country joint exercises between Japan, the Philippines, and the United States. And during the joint exercises, some self-defense force members were being transported from one place to another, and the car or the vehicle was driven probably by a Filipino driver, and it was involved in a traffic accident. One person was critically injured, the other one was also critically injured. He was in a hospital for 4 days and died on the fourth day. And I think Dr. Sasaki will explain this in more detail in a few moments. But we think there could have been many more things that could have been done. For example, the Air Self-Defense Forces have some wonderful facilities. They have planes that are fully equipped with medical equipment that could have transported this person and not kept him in a hospital for 4 days. But the end result was that he basically returned to Japan as a corpse, which is something that I simply cannot accept and allow. As a result, I went to visit the Jimujikan, which is the parliamentary vice minister or parliamentary secretary of the Ministry of Defense. And when I explained to him my my anger, he simply smiled and laughed and said, well, I understand your concern, but you know, these things take time. These things cannot be done overnight. But I was quite furious because when we talk about time, the man was in the hospital for 4 days. He could have been saved. I mean, that time is very, very important. But as I also mentioned earlier, none of this has been reported to even the committees that are responsible for such matters in the LDP. The LDP politicians who are in charge of such matters have not issued any comments. Out of frustration, I contacted Mr. Erano and asked if I might meet with him and to talk about these matters. But he said it would be very, very conspicuous if we were to meet, so perhaps I could just speak to Dr. Sasaki on the phone. I thought, however, that this was an inadequate way to approach things, and that's why I asked for your time and the opportunity to speak before you today. And I know that I will be criticized, but I am here before you today.
それからもう一つ、私はこの問題について強い関心を持ったきっかけのある出来事についてお話します。私のあのホームタウンはですね、神奈川県の逗子という小さな町なんですけど、そこでよく使う小さなタクシー会社があります。そのタクシー会社は小さいだけに、とにかくあのドライバーがですね、いつもみんなあの相当の年配の老人ばかりなんですけども、ある時迎えに来たタクシーの運転手が珍しく若い人だと。で、私は君珍しいねと聞いたら、いや実は私怪我しましたんで、今その片足になってびっこになったんでですね、タクシーの運転手をしてますと言いました。で、君は前何してたのって聞いたら、 習志野の空挺隊の落下傘部隊の隊員だった。この男が毎年行われている山梨県の北富士の総合大演習、ここでは米軍も参加して実弾も使ってする大演習なんですけど、その時に落下傘で飛び降りたら、たまたまその非常にゴツゴツした岩の上に着地してしまったの、飛び降りて。そこで足を折ってですね、結局手当てしてもらえずに一生肩がなって、軍隊を辞めました言ってました。それは私非常に印象的でしてね、官房の際になっていただいた佐々木先生にも、北富士の演習にも行って視察していて見届けてもらいたいと言いますが、相変わらず北富士の大演習には衛生兵どころか、あれも、軍医も行ってないんでしょう。こんなその大演習ってあるんでしょうかね。しかもそこで怪我人が続出してもそれをほったらかしにしてる。それがきっかけで私はもう歴代の政府がですね、自衛隊の隊員の軍人の生命といかに軽んじてですね、それに対する配慮が欠けてるかってことを痛感してきました。それが今回の10月のフィリピンでの初めての自衛隊がその軍としての出動している作業の中で亡くなって、これが全然自民党の中にも何の反響も起こさないという、この不思議な現象について私は怒りを感じています。
And I would like also to mention the reason that I became originally interested in this matter. I live in Kanagawa Prefecture in a small city called Izu, and because it is a small city, we don't have many taxis, and I often use a particular small taxi company for transportation. And because it's a rural area and because it's a small company, most of the drivers tend to be very, very elderly. However, one day the driver that came to pick me up was quite young, and I was quite surprised and asked about his background. And he said that he had been injured and that he was limping as a result, and he would limp for the rest of his life. And he happened to be part of the Self-Defense Forces Air Brigade in Narashino, and he was part of the parachute unit. And when they were having the Self-Defense Forces along with, for example, U.S. forces, a joint military exercise, and these are the kinds of exercises that are held with live ammunition on an annual basis, he happened to exit his plane and parachuted out, and he unfortunately landed on some rocks and broke his leg. And he said because help was slow in coming, the first aid system was not really in place. As a result, he was going to be limping for life, and he could no longer become a self-defense force person. When I asked Dr. Sasaki to look at the situation, it seemed to him that there were no self-defense forces, combat medics, or doctors on the scene. And this again is symptomatic of everything that I've been saying all along, which is that governments, succeeding governments in the United States, in Japan, have taken the lives and the health of the self-defense forces very, very lightly. And as a result of this carelessness that has been in place for so many years, for the first time in October, a member of the Self-Defense Forces died in the Philippines. It was the first example of a person who died as part of a military exercise. This is a tremendous thing. However, there has been no reaction within the LDP or the government. And this fills me with great fury.
じゃあ私の方からお話をさせていただきます。で、時間が短いのであらかじめ多少こう皆さんにこうハンドアウトをお渡ししましたので、詳しくはそれを見ていただきたいと思います。で、概要はですね、10月2日に、フィリピンで、自衛隊が亡くなったという報道を見ました。で、1人が亡くなって1人が暴れ骨折ったと。で、これよく見ると自衛隊員がその海外派遣されて初めて自己死したことでして、おそらく1900名ぐらいこう殉職者がいるんですが、おそらくその初めての事故ですので、これはしっかり調べた方がいいんじゃないかと。で、当然その怪我ですので、本当にこう現場の処置はどうだったのか、から病院の前プレホスピタルケアがどうだったのか、から病院の治療はどうだったのかっていうのをちゃんと調べるべきだと。で、その上で今後のその いわゆる自衛隊の医療に生かすべきだという話をさせていただいたんですが、返ってくる返事はフィリピンで適切な医療を受けたので先生の出番はないというふうにはっきり言われました。
So, I would like to speak just for a few minutes and give you more details about this incident. I think many of you may have known this, but there were news reports that said on October 2nd of this year in the Philippines, a member of the Self-Defense Forces passed away, and he was involved in an accident along with another colleague. The other person was critically injured, but he did not lose his life. This is the first this is the first instance where a self-defense force member had taken part in an active military exercise outside of the country and passed away. Until now, over the decades that the self-defense forces has been in existence, there have been over about 1,900 people, about 1,900 self-defense personnel that have died for one reason or another, but this is the first person that was actually involved in a military exercise, a joint exercise. And therefore, I thought this is a very, very important thing, and it should be reviewed. And I asked to be sent to the Philippines so that I could see for myself what exactly the nature, and learn for myself what exactly the nature of the injury originally was, what kind of pre-hospital care he received, what kind of care he received in the hospital. All of this should be thoroughly investigated. However, in spite of my many appeals to members of the government to be allowed to review this, the response that I received was that this gentleman received appropriate care in the Philippines, and there is no place for you to become involved, Dr. Sasaki.
確かに、新聞報道では、その訓練中ではなくて、訓練中に買い出しにライトバンで行って、その交通事故だっていうんですが、これは訓練に行ったことは明らかでして、その訓練の名目は災害救助になっているわけです。で、災害救助の訓練に行って、怪我した人を救助できないのか、という素直な疑問で、それはなぜそういうことが起こるのかという素直な疑問から発した質問ですが、答えがありません。で、よく調べてみると、少なくとも 2日に怪我して、6日に亡くなって4日間あるわけですが、どうも頭の怪我をしたというんですが、先ほど慎太郎さん言われたように、日本では航空自衛隊に空飛ぶ ICU という、 こう搬送があります。いわゆる重症患者さんを C-130 に乗せて連れて帰るシステムがあるんですが、そういったことも考えてないらしいということが分かりました。
I think many of you may have seen the newspaper reports. It said, the newspaper reports basically said that the person died, was involved in this accident when he was out doing some errands, in other words, to go out and buy something during the joint exercise process. However, it is very, very obvious that it was part of the exercise itself. And what's more interesting is that when I looked at the details of what kind of activities these self-defense forces were involved in, they were there to do rescue and relief work. And the point is, if they were involved in rescue and relief exercises, and yet they could not rescue and relieve their own colleagues, that is a very, very sad state of affairs. And again, I looked into this more carefully, and the accident occurred on October 2nd, but the gentleman died on the 6th. And I was told that he had some kind of a head injury. But as Mr. Ishihara said a few moments ago, the Japanese Air Self-Defense Forces have a wonderful transport system. They have a C-130 transport plane that has been converted into what they call a flying ICU, an intensive care unit. It could have been used. However, these matters were not pursued.
しかも、12月4日事務次官にその詳細を聞くと、どうもその現地には自衛隊の医官がいなくて、民間の医師が治療に対応したと。すなわち自衛隊員が訓練、しかも救急救助訓練するときに自衛隊自らの医官もなしに生かしていると。しかも現地で怪我すると民間の手に委ねてしまう。そういうことで自衛隊の命は本当に大丈夫かと。で、災害救助訓練といってもそれは名目でして、おそらくフィリピンで災害救助訓練の目的は私は不定かではありませんが、なおさら救急救助訓練であれば、医官が同行して、どういった医療を施すかという話ですし、しかもこういったところに医官がいなくて医療体制を守れるのかということで非常に疑問を感じています。
So, filled with great frustration, on December 4th, we met with the Parliamentary Vice Minister of the Ministry of Defense. And when we spoke, it seems from his comments that there was no self-defense force combat medic or combat doctor there on site. And the person was injured and he was looked after by a civilian doctor. But again, I point out that this was a rescue mission, a disaster emergency medicine exercise. And if there are no doctors there, how can we possibly have a kind of training where you try to determine the best kind of military or relief or rescue care, how it should be improved?
皆さん今日、まあ、防衛大綱を決まりましたけれども、その脅威が非常にこう皆さん我々を含めて知らされています。で、脅威に対して武力でこういろんな武器を想定していくっていうのは、それは確かに武力制圧は大事でしょうけれども、国民とか国を守る自衛隊の命を守ることも防衛ですので、そこに目を向けていただかないと困るわけです。で、今のままだとあまりにも自衛隊の命が軽視されてますので、その自衛隊にいろんなその役割だけを負わせて、一方でその自衛隊の命を保障してね、あまりに軽視すぎるということにあえて今言わないといけないと思って、こういった立場で言わせていただいています。で、私は以上です。時間が短いので、あとはもしよければ質問を受けたいと思っています。
その前にもう一つね、日本の自衛隊が非常にかわいそうで危険なのはですね、彼に交戦規定ってがないんですよ。これはね、いかなる場合にね、いかなる処置をして戦っていいかという交戦規定がない。これはね、かつて函館にミグ25という最新鋭のロシアの戦闘機がベレンコという中尉が乗って亡命してきたときに、これ大騒ぎになりましてね、これを取り戻しにロシアの空軍が特殊部隊が攻めてくるんじゃないかということで、現地の司令官の要するに独断で校舎を配置したりなんかしたんですけども、まあ、ことは大騒ぎにならずに済んだ。その後もですね、交戦規定がないと非常にその軍としても責任を果たしにくいからということで、確かクルスという倒幕の幕僚長が交戦規定を作ってほしいということを権限しましたら、時の防衛庁の長官の金丸信という金券のぼれたバカがですね、これはその許さないと、軍事介入でね、その民間が主導して行う自衛隊のその業務というものを、その軍人が阻害することになるからって、クビにしたん。以来、日本の軍隊って交戦規定がないまま、このなんとかという辻元とかいうべらべらよくしゃべる野党の議員がですね、日本の海上自衛隊がソマリアの海賊の対処に出向いたときに、これは越権、その海外出動だって、これを阻止しなくちゃいけないってんで、地元のその指導者たちに、支持者たちにそそのかして、ソマリアに行かせたんです、監視にね。その連中たちが海賊を監視するために、自衛隊を、海上自衛隊を監視するために、船を雇ったら、その船の持ち主が海賊だった。で、怖くなってですね、海上自衛隊に守ってくださいと、保護を求めたらです、ね、海上自衛隊も困りましてね、それで本省にその紹介したら、本省も困ってしまって、事例のないことですから、どういう返事が来たかというと、警察法にのっとって、禁錮30日に該当するような行為があったときは、これを積極的に対処したらよろしい、どこの要するに国の軍隊が警察法にのって、交戦来て、実戦活動するんですか。これ本当に気の毒な話でね、イラクに勝って支援したときに、道路の補修とかその他で、戦闘行為じゃなしに行ったんでしょうけど、キャンプの中にはどんどん迫撃砲が撃ち込まれて、みんな震えて、布団かぶって寝てるときに、日本の自衛隊も守ってくれたのは、確か北欧のどっかの軍隊でしたな。それで結局ノイローザになって、リーダーの隊長、今、佐藤君という立派な参議院になってるけど、30人ぐらい兵隊が辞めちゃったんですよ。これもおかしな話でね、どうやって戦っていいか、いつ戦うべきかということを決めてもらえずに、とにかく行ってこいって派兵させる自衛隊っていうのは、本当に気の毒だと私は思います。
So Dr. Sasaki, you spoke first. We believe that this is a very, very opportune time for us to be able to speak before you today because after all, the defense guidelines, the revised defense guidelines are being determined today. And when we look at the defense guidelines and we talk about defense in general, we're always told about the threats that are facing the country. And we're very, very aware of them and we're very, very frightened of them. And therefore, there is great conversation and interest about the weapons that we need to deal with these threats. But when we talk about defense, it is not simply being able to defend yourself with weapons. It means that you do something to prevent deaths or injuries or illnesses from striking self-defense force members. And so as I've been saying repeatedly, the government has repeatedly taken the lives of the self-defense forces personnel very, very lightly. They simply push them on to do very, very difficult tasks, but do not provide them with the care and support, especially the medical support that they need. And I'd now like to move to questions and answers. But before that, Mr. Ishihara wanted to add one more point, which was that one thing that concerns him very, very concerns me very, very much is that there are no formal rules of engagement for the self-defense forces. Many, many years ago in Hakodate up in Hokkaido, there was a Russian Soviet plane that was a fighter plane that was brought by a defector. And at the time, the self-defense forces head at the time was very, very nervous that the Russians might come and try to invade the area to try to retrieve their plane. But they had no rules of engagement to follow. As a result, the final result was that nothing happened. And they were able to resolve it peacefully. But if you are working as a military organization, you do need rules to know when to fight, how to fight. In fact, as a result, many years ago, there was a gentleman named Mr. Kurusu, who was the chief of the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the Self-Defense Forces, and he spoke out on behalf of his personnel and said that we do need some kind of formal rules of engagement to be put into place. However, his boss at that time was Mr. Shin Kanemaru, who you know as a very, very famous politician for being not very clean with money. And he was the head of the defense agency at that time, and he said that Mr. Kurusu had no business speaking out because this was he was a military man, and this was had to do with civilian control. As a result, he basically fired Mr. Kurusu. And as a result, we still do not have formal rules of engagement for the self-defense forces. As a result, there is another example that I'd like to point out, which is Ms. Tsujimoto, who is a very, very vocal and very lively opposition party member. When there were activities by the maritime self-defense forces off the coast of Somalia to try to counter pirates, she encouraged her supporters to go out and protest. And her protesters went out and they borrowed a boat and to get very close to the maritime self-defense forces ship. But they discovered after they'd entered the boat that the boat captain was a member, was actually a pirate himself. And so they immediately made an appeal to the maritime self-defense forces to be saved. The maritime self-defense forces, because they had no formal rules of engagement in place, did not know what to do, so they asked the government for advice as to how they should operate. The government also did not know how to respond, but after thinking about it, they said that we don't have formal military rules of engagement, but if the other party behaves in a manner in which if you were a policeman, you would arrest him for a crime that would be deserving of 30 days imprisonment punishment, then you can act in that way as a policeman. But the point I'm making is that because our self-defense forces do not have formal rules of engagement, they don't know how to protect themselves, they don't know when to fight or how to fight or under what conditions, and they only have to follow what policemen would do. Even in the self-defense forces activity in Iraq, of course they were not actually involved in any kind of military combat, but even when they were in their camps, there were mortars that were flying into their camps all the time, and they were shaking under their covers each night. They were protected by some soldiers from, I believe, some Scandinavian countries, but as a result of the stress, some 30 soldiers actually quit the forces. The point is, they are sent into very, very dangerous and impossible situations, and yet they have no rules as to when they might be able to respond to protect themselves. It's an impossible situation.
Thank you very much for your presentations. We open the floor, please, for your question. Please, just first.
Thank you. My name is Richard Tosilo from Indonesia. Actually, the accident to October is truly regrettable. And I think we have to look forward, we have to look in the future, not only criticize the accident. So that is not my question. My question is actually about the system. Dr. Sasaki, I believe you made the wonderful emergency medical response system, but at the end of your proposal, you this paper, you mentioned I did a proposal how to increase the standard, blah, 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 by 2015, 3 years ago. But I thought this proposal seemed to be in vain. So it means the SDF hesitate to use your proposal. So I don't know what happened between you and SDF. And of course, Ishihara-sama is a very great support of you, very truly excellent. But I think as a doctor, you have to maybe approach also the personal in SCF, or maybe the big boss is he doesn't like you or whatever. So because what we call it motainai, your proposal may be probably this very wonderful emergency medical response. So I would like to know actually from yourself, Dr. Sasaki, is there something wrong with between you and SDF member or maybe the boss, so that they are seems like very hesitant to accept you inside the team? Thank you.
インドネシアの記者でございます。非常に面白いお話、興味深い話、ありがとうございました。事故について非常に悲しいことなんでございますが、ただ批判することだけでは前進できないと思いますので、これからの話をしたいと思うんでございます。で、私の質問は佐々木先生への質問なんでございますが、今までその EMS、そのシステムをいろいろ構築されたということで、非常に素晴らしいお仕事をされてきたと思います。で、この英語のプロポーザルも読ませていただいたんでございますが、これ全部内容は非常に充実していると思うんでございますが、一番最後ではこれを実現したいのが2015年か6年とかって書いてあると思うんでございますが、なぜ物事は改善されてないのでしょうか。つまりもしかしたらその自衛隊の、スタッフの方たちと、うまくなんかいい関係ができてないんでしょうか。それとも何かそれより上の人とうまくいってないのでしょうか。そしてそれをなぜせっかくいい提案をされているのに、それを受け入れてもらえないと思いますでしょうか。で、そしてこれからそれをどうやって改善しようと思われますでしょうか。
いいですか、私から。確かに、英語わからないわけじゃなくて、その質問に何て答えようかと思ってたんですが、その通りです。で、ただ私は、全然事務次官で、前の事務次官から今の事務次官にも言ってきました。同じように解決しなくちゃいけないと。で、言って喧嘩してるわけじゃなくて、いわゆる自衛隊の命に対するその価値観が違ってるんですね。私はこう医師の立場ですので、命はやっぱり大事です。ところが彼らは組織とかシステムが大事ですので、いわゆる防衛大綱の中で脅威っていう形、そっちをこう充実させていくことが大事で、一方ほとんどその反面命が顧みられてないわけです。すなわち彼らの組織としての重要性と私の医者としての個人の命の重要性がこう価値観が合わないんで、そこの部分でお互いに納得できていません。だから私が別に喧嘩してここに来ているんではなくし、それからここで言えばなんとか状態が動くと思っていません。で、すなわち私が何を言いたいかと、今の自衛隊いろんな形で重荷を背負わされている一方、確かに防衛大綱、確かにあれはあれでいいんだろうけど、その防衛そのものが命っていうのを守るのも防衛ですから、それをしっかり土台として考えていかなくちゃいけないという価値観が違っている部分で、なかなかうまくいかないんだと思っています。
Actually, I do understand English fairly well, and so I was using the time when the interpreter was interpreting the question to think about how to respond to your very, very perceptive question. I have been dealing with the current vice minister, parliamentary vice minister, and his predecessor before that, and I've been making the same appeal to all three people. And we're not on bad terms. We do not fight or argue. However, I think fundamentally it is that we look at life, we look at the situation from very, very different points of views. We have different values, value systems perhaps. I am a doctor, I look at people's individual lives, and I look at protecting individual lives, and that to me is the most important thing of all. They look at not so much at individual lives, but as an organization, as an entire system. They look at the defense guidelines, see the enormous threats that are facing the nation, and they are trying to deal with these enormous threats. As I explained earlier, we're not fighting, and I have no false hopes that just because I'm speaking in front of you today that somehow they will change their thinking. And certainly in regard to the defense guidelines, they are valuable observations in that, and I'm not against what's in those guidelines at all. It's just that when we talk about protecting lives, I look at lives and I look at each individual life because I am a doctor, and they have a bigger or more wider approach. And I think it's just going to be that I have to keep on doing what I'm doing.
あと一言お話したいんですが、安倍総理は血を流してこそ同盟というふうにおっしゃってました。で、血を流してこそ同盟なんですが、誰がその血を吹くのかということを考えないといけません。で、その血を吹くのは我々医療職だと思ってますから、そのために防衛大があって防衛官がいるわけで、それが機能してなければ、血を流して同盟っても血が垂れ流されていくだけで止めようがないということで、そこの部分で我々と私と価値観が違うんだと思います。
それはおかしな話でね、誰が血を流すかって自分を流すわけじゃないんだから兵隊に流させるわけだから政府はその先ほどの佐々木先生の提案が受け入れられない理由はね私も長いこと国会にいましたか分かりますけど日本の官僚独特のねうぬぼれ独善性排他性つまり自分たちが絶対自分たちを絶対化してねほとんど外部の意見を聞かないこれはね日本の官僚の通弊ですよそれやっぱり彼らのうぬぼれなのかもしれないけどもそれほど優れた人材がいるとも思わないしね責任は取らないし責任は隠すしとにかく日本の官僚の機構の中では外部のその正しい建設的な意見ってはなかなか行政に生かされてきませんな
And Dr. Sasaki would also like to add one more point, which is that Prime Minister Abe has been noted for saying that in order to truly become a part of an alliance, we must shed blood. And that is a very, very colorful phrase. However, as a doctor, my first reaction is, well, if someone is shedding blood, we have to do everything in our power to stop it. And that is why we have combat medics. That is why we have the National Defense Medical College and produce doctors. So, in other words, simply shedding blood is not enough. We have to do something to try to stop that flow of blood. And Mr. Ishihara has stepped in to say that this is a very, very strange and ridiculous thing to say because when you say spilling blood or shedding blood, it sounds very colorful and very dramatic. However, it's not you yourself that is willing to shed blood. You're basically saying soldiers should shed their blood. And in regard to your question about why Dr. Sasaki's proposals have not been accepted by the self-defense forces or the Ministry of Defense, and I think it's because of the bureaucracy, the nature of the bureaucracy in Japan. It is very, very stolid, refusing to change. The bureaucrats are very, very have a very high opinion of themselves. They tend to exclude everyone else. They believe that they and their opinions and their thoughts and ideas are absolute. It is very, very difficult for them to open their doors and open their minds and accept the opinions of others, even though those opinions may be of a very great experts. I have a very low regard for such bureaucrats. They, again, are too full of themselves. They don't take responsibility, or they can't quite often hide their responsibility. It's very, very difficult, given this current bureaucracy situation, for an outsider, even with great expertise and very constructive opinions, or suggestions or proposals, to be accepted.
まあ、役人をですねいい方向にこう導いて正しいことをやらせるためにはね、まあ、トランプ大統領のね非常にこう強引な独裁的なそのやり方が必要なのかもしれませんけどねとにかく日本の官僚に限って言うとね正しいことをさせようと思ったら恫喝というか脅迫というかそれに近いことをしないと動かないですね例えばね私候補来るわけじゃありませんけど皆さんお使いになっている羽田の飛行場 あれを国際化したのは私と私の盟友の亀井静香です。私が都知事の時に亀井静香自民政調会長をしている時に、これはね、あそこに4本目の滑走路を作って自主的に羽田を国際化させるために、あの時運輸省の事務次官を政調室に呼んでですね、まあこちら詳しいこと言いません、あることで脅迫したんですよそれでね、彼が言うことを聞いてね、やっと4本目の高速路を作るようになった。今天皇陛下だって総理大臣だって成田から飛ばないじゃないですか、みんな羽田で飛ぶでしょ。これ本当にね、詳しいこと言いませんけど、あることで脅迫したんですそれでもしなかったら動かないですな。
So, in order to be able to take these bureaucrats in Japan and lead them into a proper or correct direction, I think perhaps you need someone with tremendous powers and will and almost a dictatorial approach, dictator-like approach, such as Mr. Trump. And frankly, I've learned over the years that the only way to get bureaucrats to do the correct thing is to basically threaten them, terrify them in some way. For example, if we look at Haneda Airport now, it is an international airport. I am the person responsible for making it an international airport. I am the person responsible for allowing a fourth runway to be built. I did this with Mr. Kamei, who was at the time an LDP politician. He was also head of the Policy Research Council or Committee. And basically, we brought the invited or ordered the parliamentary vice minister at the transport ministry to come visit Mr. Kamei in the Policy Research Council's office. And there, I won't go into specifics, we basically threatened him. As a result, the fourth runway was built, and now not even the emperor or the prime minister use Narita very often. They all use Haneda because it is a good idea to have made that an international airport. But again, I will not go into specifics, but the only way you can get bureaucrats to behave is to threaten them.
Next one, please, and then you. Short question, please.
ノボダニュース東京ニュースオペラの乾正樹と申します。石原さんは東京都知事時代に、東京都と自衛隊との大規模な防災演習といったものも行われてきましたけれども、まあ、そういったことは、まあ、国民に自衛隊というのはものすごく強くてたくましいものなんだという幻想的なものを抱かせた一方で、まあ、それはそこから、まあ、国民の目から今回のようなまあ問題というものを国民の目からそらさせてしまったのではないかと、そういったまあ政治家としての責任といったものもあるのではないかなと思うんですけれども、そういったことを踏まえて、今までの政治家人生を振り返って、まあ、これまでの教訓であったりだとか、反省であったりだとか、そういったことについてコメントいただければと思います。
So when you were governor of Tokyo, I believe that there was a very, very large exercise where the self-defense forces took part, rescue and disaster-related exercises. And it had a positive effect in that it gave the image of the self-defense forces as being very, very capable and reliable, people you can depend on. But at the same time, I believe that it had another result, which was that it took attention of the populace from the kinds of problems that you are focusing on today.As a politician, do you bear some responsibility for having caused that situation? And in a larger vein, when you look back on your life as a politician, are there things that you feel responsible for, the things that you feel that you've not taken necessarily responsibility for?
私はあの政治家としてやるべきだと思ったことをやってきたもんですからね、全然反省も後悔もしてませんな。それに東京の災害訓練で、ね、自衛隊を、ね、指導させたこともね、結局今なってみたらよかったじゃないですか。地方の災害で全部自衛隊活躍してるじゃないですか。自衛隊はそれだけで私たち身近なものになったと思いますよ。ただ自衛隊ってのは本来そのためにあるだけのものじゃなくて、これはやっぱり何といっても国防というですね、命を懸けの仕事っていうのをその彼は預かってるわけですから、私たちはやっぱりその何ていうのかな、生命を通しての仕事の尊さっていうものを理解してね、やっぱりその犠牲を最小限に食い止める、その努力を国民全体が理解してすべきだと思います。
As a politician, I have done many things. Everything that I've believed strongly in, I have pushed forward and tried to achieve. I do not look back on my life and regret anything that I have done. And as you've mentioned, the exercises that we held in Tokyo, this very, very large exercise where self-defense forces for the first time were involved in major rescue and relief efforts. This is something that I think was only a positive thing, because as a result, self-defense forces now are taken to or go to any area of Japan, any region of Japan where there are natural disasters or some kind of difficult situations. The self-defense forces are no longer some a distant presence for the average Japanese, but someone, but people that people closely identify with. Having said this, however, I do not believe that self-defense forces are simply a rescue team. That is not just their main mission. They are there to protect the nation. They are risking their lives to protect the nation. And as a result, we must honor the bravery with which they do risk their lives, and we must protect them as much as possible.
ヨーロピアンセキュリティアンディフェンスの清谷と申します。佐々木先生に伺いしたいんですけども、そもそも自衛隊というのがですね、軍隊という自覚がないから一つのこれが大きな問題ではないかと。結局戦争で隊員が死傷するという前提じゃないんで、私よく戦争ごっこやってるっていうとすぐ怒られるんですが、まさにその医療を経営しているとそこにあるんじゃないかと。今以前も2年ぐらい前に中谷大臣の時に質問したんですけども、自衛隊の部隊での以下の充足率は2割以下であると。しかも掛け持ちも含めてであると。だからほとんど多くの駐屯地、あとは護衛艦には医官がいない。どうしてるかということを質問したら、中谷さんがおっしゃったのは、その時は薬を薬剤官が配ってます、それは薬事法違反じゃないですかって聞いたら、いやそれはスーパーとかコンビニで買える売薬を配ってるだけですからというふうにおっしゃってるわけです。それを記者会見で堂々とこう大臣がおっしゃるというのも、やっぱりこう危機感の欠如じゃないかと思うんですけども、さらに加えて言えば、その陸上自衛隊で言えば、以下メディックが150人に1人ぐらいしかいない。よその国だと15人から20人に1人いるわけですよね。だから非常にこう医療をメディックを非常に軽視している自衛隊というのは、その旧軍以上にこう隊員に対する命に関してのケアがないと思うんですけども、その辺やはりその医療の費用というのは自衛隊の医療の予算が少ないこともやっぱり大きな問題だと思うんですけど、いかがでしょうか。ちなみにあと一つ、防衛大綱で衛生に書いてあるんですけども、医官とかメディックの充足率を上げるということは一言も書いておりません。
I have a question for Dr. Sasaki. I'm from the European Security and Defense publication. Sorry, and one of the reasons I believe that there isn't much focus on providing adequate medical care to the self-defense forces is that the self-defense forces personnel do not necessarily think of themselves as being in actual harm's way, or actually being part of a military organization where they could go to war and actually possibly die. I often refer to the situation as that they are playing at war. And perhaps this is a reason, because they do not expect to be injured, that the medical care services are not that adequate. In fact, I raised a similar question to Minister Nakatani when he came to the press club some years ago. And I mentioned to him that the number of doctors present is very, very low. You look at the camps, you look at the escort ships, the destroyers, and there are many that do not even have any medics there. And his response was that sometimes it was less than 20% or something of that nature. But he said that that was not such a terribly serious problem, because the self-defense forces had access to pharmaceuticals. I said, isn't that a violation of the pharmaceuticals law, that only certain people are allowed to hand out, prescription drugs, and first of all, they have to be prescribed by a doctor? And he said, oh, no, it's not a problem, because basically they're distributing over-the-counter kinds of drugs that you can buy in a regular pharmacy. And this, of course, I think is very, very problematic. I think the current numbers are something like one medic for 150 people, something like that. It's very, very clear that medical care is very much lacking. And one reason, I believe, is that the budget for medics or medical care in the self-defense forces is very, very low. In fact, looking at the defense guidelines that have been announced recently, there is no indication that the budget for medics is being or medical care is being raised at all.
Last question. 全くその通りで、前にウィルにも書かせていただいたんですが、自衛隊は愛される自衛隊っていうのを標語にやってきましたので、本来の目的がちょっとずれてるわけですね。でそもそも自衛隊ですので国を守るんで、愛されるというよりは頼れる自衛隊でなければいけないんですが、いわゆる自衛隊の存在そのものがある程度中途半端な形になってますので、その分その愛されるという言葉でごまかされてきたんで、その分今まで確かにいわゆる平和がこう過ぎてきたんで、平和に過ぎてきたんで、本当に自衛隊の国を守るというその部分が重要視されなくてこう来てってしまったという危機感の甘さがあります。したがってある日突然こういう形で PKO だということで、本当に戦わないかん、あるいは戦うかもしれないって言った時に、本来の目的がようやく今芽生えてきたんで、それ以前はおそらく自衛隊のいわゆる自分たちの健康管理ぐらいしか考えてなかったんで、その発言が中谷防衛長官の発言だと思います。で今後今私が問題しているのは、今までは戦争もなかった、巻き込まれもなかったからそれでよかったんだろうけど、これだけ危機感が増して、それいろんな活躍をさせるときには、やっぱり自分たちが自ら怪我したときどうするか、いわゆる戦勝医療についてやらなくちゃいけないという危機感は全く欠落していると思います。でそれを何回もこうや僕は言ってきたんですが、なかなかそこには至らないということが現状だと思います。で予算に関して言えば、確かに充足率はひどいもんでして、防衛大は、44年間2018年で2400名ぐらいの医官がいるんですが、実際に勤務したら820名ぐらいしか行かなくて、1600名はじゃあどこ行っちゃったんだと。すなわち医者を育てるための防衛大ではなくて、医官を作るための医官が基本的には1600名もいなくなってて、じゃあそのおそらく1600名は民間に行ってると思うんですね。そうすると単なる医学部と変わらないじゃないかと。すなわち危機感が、そういうところの危機感の欠落もそこにあります。したがってそこに関して、それは充足率なんとかしようかという議論すらなくて、それをただ放っておいているのが今の防衛大なんで、このままで防衛大の存在が疑われると思います。
Yes, actually, I wrote an article similar to what you suggested in the magazine, monthly magazine Will, that over the years, the slogan for the self-defense forces is troops that will be loved by the Japanese population. That's a very, very nice phrase. However, it is different from the original reason for the self-defense forces coming into existence. It should not be a force that should be loved by the people, but a force that can be depended on by the people. For many, many years, I think we have been blessed with peaceful situation, so we don't have this sense of crisis. Yet, things are changing in the world, and someday, very soon, suddenly out of the blue, we may be asked to take part in a peacekeeping operation, and the self-defense forces themselves might be subjected to actual personal injury or other dangers. Until now, when we talked about medical care for the self-defense forces, they basically thought about maintaining their own physical well-being. But now, and I think that is the basis on which Mr. Nakatani, the defense minister, made those comments. But now, people have to change, and self-defense forces, people must think about their own physical possibly being injured. So these are kinds of the changes that we're seeing. And in regard to your comment about the medical care budget being inadequate and the medical medics budget being inadequate, I absolutely agree. When we look at the National Defense Medical College, over the past 44 years, they have produced some 2,400 doctors. And of course, they do serve some time. They must serve some time in the self-defense forces. But at present, out of those 2,400 doctors, there are only 820 doctors in the self-defense forces now. That means out of those 2,400, 1,600 have disappeared somewhere. And probably what they have done is they have served their time in the self-defense forces and then gone on to the civilian sector, which means that what is the point of having this medical college? It's just another medical department that you can find in any other universities. Still, the sense of crisis is not prevalent in this university, but eventually I think it will come back to haunt them.
Thank you. Last question, please.
Governor Ishihara, thank you for coming to the club today. I have a question that goes back to your early days as governor. You are the person who initiated the casino legalization movement in Japan. You're kind of the godfather of what has recently happened many years after you began the movement. My question for you is, do you still believe that one of the three casinos must be in Tokyo, your former city, or are you happy to have them anywhere around the country as the person who started this movement in the country?
ありがとうございます。石原、様が知事、になってた時にはカジノの構想を非常に強く、進めてたわけであります。まあ、そのカジノ構想のゴッドファザーとも言えるかと思います。まあ、今3つのカジノの話が出ているわけでございますが、その3つのうちの1つは必ず東京に作らなくてはいけないと思われますのでしょうか。それとも日本どこでもいいからとりあえず3つが建設されればいいと思われますのでしょうか。
いや、私別に東京でなくてもいいと思いますよ。あちこちにあったっていいんじゃないですか。アメリカなんかですね、非常に疲弊しているインディアンの、原住民の居住区にね、お金儲けのためにちっちゃなカジノを作ってたりしてますね。私は熱海の、ね、温泉地は疲弊してきてますし、ああいうところがですねリバイブしていくためにも構わないんじゃないかな。
I don't think the casinos have to be in Tokyo at all. I think they could be built in other places that need them. Especially, for example, if you look at the United States, there are areas where there is not much economic activities. For example, the indigenous population, American Indians, have set up companies and managed to run casinos very successfully. If we look at Japan, for example, Atami is a hot springs resort that has seen economic activity drop. They would, I think, be a very good place. That would be a very good place.For example, to have a casino.
It's very short. We extend it.
Tokyo の朝日新聞の記者で山本と申します。
あれ？
はい。
どこの人？
東京の朝日新聞の記者で山本と申します。本日の趣旨と異なることを質問を許しください。オリンピックの進捗状況について、石原さんから現状を感じられていることを一言いただければと思います。よろしくお願いします。
So I'm from the Asahi, and I apologize for asking a question that's not
on the agenda. 私はリタイアしましてね、まあ、直接関与してますから、森君が責任者なのでやってるわけで、森君に任せてるわけですから。
So I wanted to ask a question about how you view the current progress of the preparation for the Olympic Games to be held in Tokyo. And the response is that I'm now retired and my former colleague, Mr. Mori, former Prime Minister, is responsible for this and I leave everything up to him.
Thank you very much. This wraps up our event today. I would like to thank Mr. Ishihara and Mr. Sasaki for coming again to the press club. As a token gift, we would like to give Mr. Sasaki 1 year honorary membership. Governor Ishihara is already associate member in our club, and that's great to have him around. Please come again to the bar and to enjoy the new building. Sasaki-sensei, thank you very much for
coming.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank Takamoto-san for her interpretation today. Thank you.